Australia, leading by the company in the US Treasury, and because growth of the economy was trending down, well, the incentive to invest wasn't really so strong. So you had more saving, more supply of money, less investment demand, and the net impact was to drag interest rates down.
Okay, and so obviously a different environment, and you know, talk to us then about, you know, when I think about State Powell today and if those Fed speakers, they're constantly reminded higher for longer. What is the changing dynamic paradigm that really speaks to a very different interest rate environment and cost of money going forward? And is it now more normal where we're going? We consistently, I feel like, talk about, remind everybody, you know, money costs nothing. That was the unusual part. But help me out and make some clarity about whether or not that's the case. And are we just getting back more to normal?
Short-term, Carol, all eyes on the Fed, all eyes on whether there's another rate hike or not. But at a more fundamental level, there's also some structural forces which are going to be keeping interest rates high in the long term. Think about the wide deficit in the U.S. Government, China, all of that government borrowing. Think about how China has stopped pumping money into U.S. treasury. Think about how the baby boom generation have now retired. They've stopped saving, they're spending down their savings. Think about climate change and the $30 trillion which our colleague Bloomberg NEX say is required to get to the net zero transition. You put all of these things together, you've got a picture of savings coming down, investment coming up. And if we think a bit further out, we think beyond Powell and the next Fed move, it's those forces which we think are going to be keeping interest rates high into the medium term.
All right, so I'm going to tell you, I consider Tim and I
the interest rate is a reflection of the supply and the demand for money. Now the Fed can manipulate that in the short term by setting the federal funds rate at a certain level through quantitative easing, but there's also all of these huge macro forces which are determining how much people save and how much people and businesses invest, right? Think about demographics. If the population is young, they're going to be saving for retirement. If you've got an older population, well, they've already retired, they're not saving anymore, they're spending down their savings. Think about the business sector. If the economy is humming, they're going to think investment means more profit, I'm going to invest more tomorrow. If the economy is sluggish, well, the incentive to invest isn't there. So what we try and wrap our heads around in this Business Week piece, it's certainly not beyond the great minds of Carol and Tim, but it is conceptually a bit structural forces. What are those big structural forces driving saving, driving investment? And when we pull those numbers together, what we see is a big transition from a world of a lot of saving and not much investment, the world which is dragging interest rates down over the last 30 years, to a world in the future where there's less saving, more investment, and interest rates go up. That means for equities, for real estate, and of course the big one, for the cost of servicing the US government debt.
Tom, I wonder as you guys do this and write it out in the story that's in Business Week, but could something change that? And I think about all those years that Greenspan talked about how productive we were, and could a higher level of productivity, could a higher growth rate kind of change your thinking about this?
I think there's a lot of uncertainties here, Carol. Let's just talk about a couple of them. Let's talk about the productivity question, which you raised. If we go into a world where AI driving huge gains in productivity and huge growth in the economy, well, if growth is booming, people are going to want to invest to get a piece of the profit from that growth. That's going to push investment higher. That will be something that will push interest rates higher. Think about the climate change piece of it. Our colleagues at Bloomberg NEF say $30 trillion required to get the net zero on carbon emissions. Is the world going to deliver that $30 trillion in investment? Or are we going to keep kicking that can down the road? So there's a lot of big questions about how the future is going to shape out. But when we think about the base case, demographics, productivity, the response to climate change, where the place we come out is that this period of falling interest rates is over, and really, no matter what Powell and the team do at the next meeting and the meeting after that, we're moving into a world of higher interest rates in the years ahead.
So I'm going to go back to historic, and I've worked with colleagues who talked about paying mortgage rates of 15, 16, 17%. Is this more logical, though? The environment, and you just feel uncomfortable because we all got really comfy, you know, when money was essentially free, it felt like.
Yeah, I mean, it's not better or worse, right? It just changes the pattern of winners and losers in the economy, right? Let's say that you are someone who owns a house and owns stocks, and you're printing on the value of your house and the value of your equity as something which is going to juice your income in retirement. Well, if we're moving into a higher interest rate world, what that means is actually the pressure on real estate prices, the pressure on stock prices, is going to be to come down. And so perhaps people who can cancel on that 401k, their equity market investments, and then steadily gaining in value to finance their retirement. Well, perhaps that's not going to be there.
I thought it was. But stocks still move higher in high interest rates and rate environments historically. Maybe we didn't see what they did in, you know, the S&P 500 did over the last 10 years. But I do think, Tom, you know, this is not, we're not in uncharted territory here, right?
So we're not moving into a world where interest rates are going to be higher than they've ever been before. We're moving into a world where the trajectory of interest rates is going from falling to right. Interest rates feel kind of the opportunity cost of investing in equity, the opportunity cost of investing in real estate. The interest rates are higher, well, the opportunity cost of putting your money in equity, putting your money in real estate goes up. And what that means is, on balance, you'd expect more downward pressure on those asset prices.
Well, I think about this whole idea of, like, when the tide goes out, right? You do wonder, the longer this sticks around, whether it's real estate, whether it's corporate stocks, you know, companies that just exist. It was interesting to hear Elon Musk on the call. He talked so much about his race, and, you know, we talked kind of about a quarter down the hall. This is all I have.
So I think that's completely right, Carol. I mean, in a world where money is free, you can build castles in the air, right? You can have a dream that you're going to build an electric vehicle, which is going to make profit 10 years' time or 20 years' time, and 20 years' time is going to deliver huge profit, and you can finance that project because money is free, right? And in a world where money is expensive, that becomes harder. So perhaps some of those kind of Silicon Valley projects become harder to deliver. On the other side of it, well, in a world where money is free, Bitcoin looks like a really good idea. Crypto looks like a really good idea, right? You have kind of speculative frenzy, right?
Yeah.
In a world where money is expensive, well, maybe people think a bit harder before piling into these bubbles, and maybe you have financial markets which are a bit less bubble prone.
6%? Not unrealistic. 30 seconds left, Tom. And that 10 year.
So it's one of the things that we consider, Carol.
Yeah.
So Let's think about a world where US deficits remain wide, the government's still borrowing.
Right.
Let's think about a world where we get serious about climate change and invest the money we need to get to net zero carbon emissions. That's where you can start seeing that 6% 10-year treasury yield in our model.
Well, and again, we listen so closely to Fed Chair Jay Powell. I mean, this just kind of fits into this dynamic. Higher for longer, we certainly got that message, and this story fits so much into that. Tom, thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Tom Orlick is chief economist at Bloomberg Economics. This story in the current new issue of Bloomberg Businessweek on newsstands now, on the Bloomberg terminal, and online at bloomberg.com/businessweek. Ready to fire, right?
It doesn't matter if I'm ready or not. They're here.
We're all going to live in it. It feels that way. This is Bloomberg.
Wherever your business takes you, Bloomberg 960 is here with you.
Crossing.